I work on the problem of enabling robots to navigate in complex environments. And I address many domains, but one particular focus is the underwater environment. And we're working on a challenge problem of having a robot that could help a human scuba diver to navigate over large distances to find objects. And so I call it kind of like a spatial artificial intelligence, is something that Andrew Davison in London coined the phrase of, how can we have robots that can kind of know what is where in the world and can help people to perform complex tasks. And this photo actually on the right is one of my recent Navy officer graduate students doing dive training at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. We're seeking ways to develop the tools to enable advanced underwater perception and navigation, but using everyday terrestrial environments as proxies and to try to understand some of the structure of the problem. And so my research group, it's so wonderful. I feel so lucky to be an MIT professor, having like a group of about a dozen PhD students, graduates, master's students, undergraduates. And we've looked at many different problems over the years. And some of my happiest days are at the MIT Sailing Pavilion, where we have a little lab there where we can throw robots in the river and test things out before we try them in more complex environments. Imagine a robot tasked with exploring an underwater environment. And the fundamental to me is the question of, where am I, localization. I believe that knowing our position, knowing a robot's position, is an essential sort of scaffolding for higher level sort of intelligent behavior. So where am I going, how should I get there? Where is everything around me is sort of, and there's a pretty well-defined problem in robotics of trying to locate objects and the robot, and I've worked on it my whole life. I joke that I'm still working on my PhD thesis 35 years later. But increasingly, what is everything around me? Incorporating semantic information is a really key research theme, and especially enabled by new tools in machine learning, we can add the kind of what aspect to the where aspect of the robot navigation problem. So the general problem here captures many different application scenarios. For example, we envision robots to help with aquaculture, to help feed the planet with the growing population, exploring coral reefs. There are many defense and other applications underwater. But the same sort of problem setting applies in self-driving vehicles and for, say, the kind of robots that Russ talked about to enable imagine the navigation piece of taking objects around your house. I have a dream of a problem I call EscapeX Undo for the physical world, if anyone's an Emacs user. Like, imagine if you had you could move a few objects, or your grandchildren could move a few objects, and the robot could automatically put them back where they were. And so we formulate this as a semantic, simultaneous localization and mapping problem, where we have to challenge, first we have to choose a representation, how do we represent the world? Then we have this inference problem, which combines both discrete and continuous states. And this gets extremely computationally challenging very quickly. But we also want to build systems and make them autonomous and deploy them in real world applications. So the kind of newer piece, and I have a recent PhD student, Kevin Doherty, just graduated from my group. He's just joined the perception team of Atlas at Boston Dynamics, trying to, Kevin did a recent thesis looking at how we combine semantic information with SLAM and some of the sort of subproblems therein. And I'm gonna give you a few examples, but we had a wonderful dinner on Sunday night with some of the lab's Turing Award winners, Bob, and I recall that Butler Lampson said, hey, paraphrasing, forget language models, I just want to know, where's my gray sweater in my house? And I've dreamed for a long time of what I call Google for the physical world. If you're doing a startup now in robotics, if you could do ChatGPT for the physical world, you'd get a lot of attention. But I almost want to go back 20 years in time. I feel like we still don't have a physical search engine. We need Google for the physical world, being able to know what is where in the environment dynamically over time. And so, so the inference and representations for this spatial intelligence problem are still a goldmine for PhD student theses. And these questions of where am I and what objects are around me are sort of timeless. And we've made a lot of progress, but we still have a lot more to do. And so we call this object-based mapping. And existing approaches tend to encounter situations when there's ambiguity. Many of the similar objects or highly complex situations. We're working on generic approaches that can generalize to difficult environments, and in particular, underwater. The sort of domain shift to go underwater makes things a lot harder, and we need systems, for example, that can learn with fewer examples because we have much limited data. So I wanted to give you a little overview. What I really wanted to do was a live demo, but the setup here and the time constraints don't make it. But I'm also fortunate to be part of the larger, what we call the embodied intelligence community in CSAIL of about 20 faculty. And I wanted to advertise some recent work happening by some collaborators. Have this wonderfully energetic postdoc named Ge, who's working with some Europeans in my lab, collaborating with colleagues such as Leslie and Philip and Williamson, a PhD student. And there's this, Rod Brooks has said anything, it quotes Arthur Clarke, that anything that's sufficiently advanced is indistinguishable from magic. And there's this magic in the machine learning and vision community called NeRFs recently. And here are some NeRF models just built yesterday. This is the room that we're in now, so without all the people. And these are, so this is not my work yet. We're collaborating on how to transition this to robot navigation and action. Here's a NeRF model for outside CSAIL, just taking an iPhone around outside. And focus on the bicycles, like the quality of the visual rendering. And we have younger faculty like, that are real experts in this. Here's an overhead view of flying a drone around this building. And this just kind of blows me away that this kind of the potential for these compact neural representations that can use modern machine learning to capture 3D models of the world, and how do we make them useful for robots. So that's a brief advertisement of some of the fun happening 100 meters away in our lab. Going back to my own lab, we have a recent paper just accepted for IROS in 2023, and this is kind of taking some old ideas and recombining them with some new techniques. We call it gap slam, Gaussian approximation, and particle filters for real-time slam. And my student Chad, who's here with his laptop for a demo, if anyone has time, if there's a break, that we can use a machine learning detector to detect objects, for example, chairs, trash cans, and we have a real-time system now that can detect the objects and then so the basic idea is to develop an object-based SLAM system that can locate objects. Now, trash cans and chairs tend to move a lot, and sort of an issue of how do you detect what are dynamic objects that are not good for recognizing your position, what are good objects. But we've managed to sort of create a real-time SLAM system in the lab that can handle sort of, we just picked 20 categories of objects, trash cans, coffee mugs, and so forth. And we did a demo yesterday in this room, and if we had time, we'd show you. But so part of the challenge is how you initialize objects. We're just using the centroid of the object. We have separate efforts doing pose estimation, and there's a lot of work in computer vision doing that. But initially, you just have the monocular bearing to an object. You can't locate it, but by combining data from multiple vantage points, you can collapse a set of particles to a Gaussian representation. That's a surprisingly good estimate using the centroid. So getting towards finishing up. So we're developing the tools to enable physically embodied spatial AI. My dream is mobile robots that can build and maintain models of the world over achieving lifelong learning and helping people. We believe in human amplification, not human replacement, and especially trying to do it underwater. This is particularly challenging. And going back to the problem I mentioned at the beginning, what we've been up to at the Sailing Pavilion the past few months, my student Brendan, who's a Navy officer finishing his PhD thesis, we have an autonomous surface vehicle, a jet, a motorized kayak that a person can drive around in, but it's autonomous. And we're going to, it's with only range measurements using an acoustic modem device. Navigation is so hard underwater that you need to maneuver, and we're doing circling and zigzags to locate the object underwater. And so we're kind of doing an incremental crawl, walk, run approach. First, we used manual kayaks, then autonomous kayaks, and we're just proceeding to the point of using real human scuba divers with acoustic modems, working with Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. And so it's tremendously fun to work on all these problems. I feel really fortunate. And please check out, send me an email if you want to find out any more information about our papers. Thank you very much.